It's my great pleasure and honor to introduce Yujiro Kawamata from the University of Tokyo. A student of Iitaka, Kawamata has been for many years one of the leaders of the school studying birational geometry. As you, I'm sure, all know, there's been enormous progress in that field, really a revolution. It's one of the things our age will be known for, I'm convinced, is the progress that's been made recently there. Along with his colleague Mori, Kawamata's name appears on practically every page of text about this subject, and not only his name, but his initials. It's so iconic. So we're going to hear from one of the great masters of the subject about categorical crepant resolutions of simple singularities. Professor Kawamata.
For the nice introduction. So in this talk, I'd like to talk some conjectures or open problems on the theory of category of derived categories. That is, so there is some very strange parallelism between minimum model theory and category theory. So there is a knowledge on minimum order theory a lot. So from that, one can guess things in category theory. So that is my motivation. So let's start with algebraic variety X. So that I assume that it is smooth and projective. So over some field. Okay. So such algebraic variety has algebraic and geometric structure on a set. So it's a set with such additional structure. For example, if the field is complex number field, then X is a complex manifold, so it has a transcendental topology. But if the field is more general thing, then it has a Zariski topology. And also it has algebraic structure. And that is determined by the space of functions. So some of the functions are algebraic and some are not. So by the set of algebraic functions, one can put algebraic structure on this set. And moreover, one can consider, for example, vector bundles and so on, algebraic vector bundles. So there are a lot of rich algebraic structures on it. So this is algebraic variety. And then this is abelian category of coherent sheaves on X. It's a set, so it is a category. So category is a little bit different thing. So it is a set. And as additional structure, there are arrows. So if you take 2 points on this set, so the points are called objects. So let's take A and B, 2 points, and then there are a set of arrows called homospace, home from A to B. And these arrows put additional structure on this set, and this is category. And I always assume that this set of arrows for any fixed 2 points are k-vector spaces. So this is so-called k-linear category. And also in this category of coherent sheaves, it has a structure of abelian category. So that means that you have injection, surjection, and exact sequence, and so on. So this is done. For the homology theory is carried out in this kind of category usually, but this abelian category is nothing new from X. So X and the coherent of X are categorically equivalent. So to give X and to give coh X is the same. So there is nothing new. For example, a point small x in variety x corresponds to the skyscraper sheaf, Ox. And this is a simple object. And as a simple object in the Abelian category, simple object, the smallest object, which doesn't have any sub-object and quotient object. So this correspond is bijective, and as I said, it is recovered. And also other structure, topology and algebraic structure on large X is recovered from categorical structure, these arrows and so on. So there is nothing new, so it's not so interesting. But if you go to a derived category, then things are different. So DB stands for bounded derived category of this Abelian category. So Abelian category is just a set of sheaves. But instead, we consider a complex of sheaves. And the object of this derived category is bounded complex. So only finite number of things are non-zero, and other ingredient are zero. Yeah. So this is a bounded complex, and all the bounded, the totality of the bounded complex is this derived category. But in this category, if I take just a category of complexes, then there is nothing new again. But I take a homotopy category. So for example, if you have a sheaf, then it has a resolution, free resolution, for example. So then you can replace one sheaf by a complex and so on. And that is done in homological algebra. So if you want to calculate extension of modules and so on, then you replace one module by a free resolution. Yeah. In this way, in this bounded derived category, or derived category, quasi-isomorphism become isomorphism. Quasi-isomorphism is that homomorphism between complexes which induces isomorphism on the homology level. So with this homotopicalization, things becomes very interesting. This derived category is not Abelian category anymore. So there is no injection or subjection or filtration or anything. So, because a small thing can be replaced by a large thing by taking resolution. So there is nothing compared, and there are no simple objects. So there is no smallest object, but smallest objects has still smaller object, and so on. But it has a structure called the triangulated category. So first of all, it has a shift functor. So the complex is very long, so you can shift complex to the left, and that is shift one functor. If you shift two, the position is shifted, then it is shift two shift functor, and so on. And the distinguished triangle replaces exact sequence. For example, if you have exact sequence of sheaves, so written at the bottom, so 0, A, B, C, 0, then this exact sequence in the Abelian category becomes a distinguished triangle in the derived category. So even if they are sheaves, so suppose that these are just sheaves, but in a larger category of this derived category, this becomes a distinguished triangle. And that by that replacement, everything works well. For example, if you have this short exact sequence, then usually you have long exact sequence of extension module and so on. And that is recovered by these triangles and so on. So the key point is that different but related varieties may have equivalent derived categories. So there are more symmetries, and that you can grasp more essential things than just apparent things. So, for example, birational geometries is birational invariants are more important by regular invariant because it grasps something hidden and more essential. And in the same way, so apparently the two varieties may have different category of sheaves, but they may have the equivalent derived categories, and then these varieties are very closely related in some way. And from derived category, so derived category, if you derived categories has more symmetry, so it is quite so round existence. And then, so the heart, so coherent category of coherent shift is the heart, and this is kind of slice. So you can cut a globe by different way, then you get different hearts. And this way of cutting is called the T-structure. So you have a lot of hearts. So yeah, so there are many hearts in a triangle category. So for example, if you take projective space of dimension n, then the bounded derived category of coherent sheaves of the projective space is equivalent to something else. This is finite generated modules of R, and the derived category of something. The R is the only also finite dimensional non-commutative algebra. It's a very explicit thing called Gelfand correspondence. So Minya Popa will talk about this in the algebraic geometry section. Anyway, so there is a finite dimensional algebra which is non-commutative, and if you take Abelian category of all the modules of this finite generated modules, and then take derived category, then you get something else. And they come from different T structures, and these hearts are quite different. But the categorical equivalence reveals the structure of category sheaves. Yeah. So R is related to representation theory of, R is actually representation algebra of, R is a quiver algebra, and mod R is a representation of this quiver algebra. So this is a relationship with representation theory. Now, there are good properties of the derived category of coherent sheaves on smooth projective varieties. So this is only true for in the case when X is smooth and projective. So that if there are singularity, then these are false. And X is, smoothness is the most important part. So the first property is that this is finite type. So if you take arbitrary point or element A and B in this derived category, and then what is home P? Home P is that the home set from A to B shifted by P. So remember that B is a complex. So you can shift B by P. So P is an integer. And this is called home P AB. For example, if A and B are just sheaves, then home P of AB is just a pth extension of A to B. But in general, A and B are complexes, and in this case, I write this home P. And the finite type property is that if you take all the P's and the sum is finite dimensional. So that means that all these linear spaces are finite dimensional, and moreover, most of them are zero. The second property is that they are saturated. This is another finite property. So exact functor is a functor which sends shift functor to shift functor and distinguished triangles to distinguished triangles. So these are called exact functor. Like in the case of Abelian categories, exact functor sends short exact sequence to short exact sequence. But in this case, distinguished triangle is sent to distinguished triangle. So any exact functor from this bounded derived category to bounded derived category of points. So P stands for just one point. So in other words, coherent of P is just a category of finite dimensional vector spaces. And then if you have this exact functor, then it is representable in the sense that there exists an element A such that this functor is just a home functor, isomorphic to home functor. Yeah. So this is saturated. So in other words, if you take all these kind of exact functors, then there are no more points. So it is kind of closed or compactness. And third property is that the existence of Serre functor. It is an automorphism of this category, such that for any two element A and B, so this is Serre duality holds. So this is a bivariant Serre duality. So usual Serre duality, it has just one thing and or locally free sheaf and so on. But in the case when X is smooth, then anything can be replaced by finite complex of locally free sheaves by Serre's theorem. So this more general Serre duality holds. And this Serre functor is realized by tensoring by the canonical sheaf, omega X, shifted by dimension of X. So omega X is an invertible sheaf on X. This is a holomorphic volume form. And here, so dimension appears. So that means that the category knows its dimension. And the Serre functor is unique if it exists. So dimension automatically come. Dimension is an invariant of a category. So as I said, the smoothness of X is essential. So for example, if small x is a singular point of X, then home away to AP is non-zero for all positive integer P. So it's infinite dimensional if you take a sum. And then, so example of Serre functor, so if X is n-dimensional Calabi-Yau variety, so Calabi-Yau variety is Calabi-Yau manifold. So it is n-dimensional and the canonical sheaf omega X is trivial. Yeah. Then of course from this expression, it follows that the Serre functor is isomorphic to the shift functor. And in this, if this holds, then this category is called n Calabi-Yau category. So the derived category of n-dimensional Calabi-Yau varieties is n Calabi-Yau category. Now I go to minimum model theory. So the model is a two-dimensional case. It is very classically well known. But this is an important model, and everything is developed on this foundation. So I explain two-dimensional minimum models. So let X be an algebraic surface, so that is smooth projective variety of dimension 2. And then C is a curve on X, and it is called minus 1 curve if it is isomorphic to projective line, and the normal bundle has degree minus 1. So it is called minus 1 curve. Very, very easy terminology used these days. In the old days, it was called exceptional curve of the first kind. So, and Castellanova's contraction theorem says that if you have a minus 1 curve, then you have a birational morphism F from X to another surface X prime, which is smooth and projective, such that C is contracted to a point P, and the rest is isomorphic. The rest is untouched. So this is Castellanova's contraction theorem, and that is much more generalized to base point free theorem in higher dimension. Now, minimum models is no more minus one curve, and you can achieve always such minimum model after finite number of steps. So this is theory of minimum models in dimension 2, and correspondingly, the following thing happens in derived category. So X is a surface, and you take derived category of X, and then the invertible sheaf on this curve of degree minus one is a sheaf called C naught, and then C naught is exceptional object. So exceptional curve, if you have exceptional curve or minus one curve, then you have exceptional object. Exceptional object is defined in the following, in this way. So this endomorphism ring, total endomorphism ring, is isomorphic to the ground field as a graded ring. So this has ring structure. Of course, this case, ring structure is not so important because only P is equals to zero is important. But in other cases, the ring structure becomes more important. So I put in this way. So it's an exceptional object. And this exceptional object is pushed down to zero object by this Bayesian morphism from X to X naught, X prime. So it is a relative object. And the new surface X prime has derived category, and that is characterized by as a left orthogonal complement of this exceptional object. So C naught generate triangular category inside derived category of X, and so left orthogonal, so B is orthogonal to C naught shifted by P if home set is zero. So this is this equation is equivalent to this symbol. So new derived category is the same as left orthogonal complement of the exceptional object. So in this way, the contraction of the minus one curve is replaced by taking left orthogonal complement. And then there's an important property that any element A in the derived category of X is decomposed in this way. So this is a distinguished triangle, and B is defined by push forward and pull back. In this way, I can always form this distinguished triangle, and the third term belongs to this exceptional category. So this says that the whole category is generated by this piece and this piece. So from two components, the whole category is generated. Now this kind of phenomena is generalized to semi-orthogonal decomposition by Bondar. So category A is decomposed to C and B. And B and C are triangulated subcategories. That means it is stable under shift. And also if you take distinguished triangle, then if two terms of the triangle belongs to, for example, B, then the third term belongs to B too. And then B is called a triangulated subcategory. So stable under distinguished triangles and shifts. The condition is that the first condition is that B is perpendicular to C. That means home set from B to C is zero. And this perpendicular condition is not symmetric. So B perpendicular C is not C perpendicular B, because the home set is not symmetric. And A is generated by B and C, as in the sense I previously explained. So, for example, in the case of surfaces, the whole derived category is decomposed into exceptional object and the contracted surface category. And there are other examples. So, Berenson theorem says that the derived category of a projective space is decomposed into n plus one object. So this is. And all of these n plus one objects are exceptional in this category. So this is exceptional object, And left orthogonal is this part. And in the left orthogonal, you have one exception object, and then the rest is again left orthogonal inside this smaller category with respect to this exception object. In this way, it is completely decomposed. And if the category is completely decomposed in this way, then we say that the sequence is full exceptional collection. So full means nothing left. And that is the base where in the example, I said that the derived category of projective space is equivalent to the category of representation of Kawamata algebra. So this is a base for that. One can generalize this example in the next line. So all toric varieties have also full exceptional collections consisting of sheaves. And if the whole category A is finite type saturated and having Serre functor, then B and C inherit this kind of property. So if you start with very nice category, then and if you take decompositions, semi-orthogonal decompositions, then the smaller category has also good property. For example, if the Serre functor of B is determined by this formula. So Serre functor of B is a functor from B to B. So first embed B to A, and then take Serre functor of A, and then come back to B by taking right adjoint functor. So this is the way how to get Serre functor in B. There's an important remark that the derived category has no orthogonal decomposition. So orthogonal means not semi-orthogonal, but both ways. So B perpendicular C, but not C perpendicular B. So that never happens. And as a corollary, if the category is N color BL, then it has no semi-orthogonal decomposition at all. Because if B perpendicular C, and then I can use Serre functor to reverse the order. But by reversing the order, it's only the shift functor is Serre functor. And B is stable under the shift, so C is perpendicular to B again, and it is impossible. So Calabi-Yau category is something minimal, very, very, very minimal thing. It has no decomposition at all. So now I explain general minimum model program. So it is a sequence of variational maps, and each step is one of the following. The first one is a contraction of codimension 1 subvariety, like minus 1 curve. So this is very similar to the surface case. But in higher dimension, there is another operation called the flip. And that is isomorphism in codimension 1. That means you delete some closed subset which has higher codimension, not codimension 2 or more, and then put something again, small dimensional thing again. So this is similar to surgery in topology. And this kind of surgery thing is also necessary in higher dimension, but they are very similar anyway. I'll explain that. So first of all, so even if X is smooth, the next one is already singular. So that is a difficulty. But still, canonical divisors are Q-Cauchy. That means some multiple are Cauchy divisors. So that means some multiple has local equations. It described by one equation. So you can pull back Q-Cauchy divisors by pulling back the equation and also taking intersection number by taking this equation. So still many things in the surface theory can be generalized in this case. And the important inequality is the following. So even if the operation is divisory contraction or flip, we always have inequality of canonical divisors. Canonical divisor always decreases strictly. So this is a common resolution. So this is a birational thing, and then you construct a hat from the thing, and on the top floor ceiling, if you pull back canonical divisor from both ends, then there is strict inequality in both cases. So, and the end product is the either minimum model or a modifiable space. Minimum model is that the canonical divisor is numerically effective in this sense, and modifiable space has negative intersections. So canonical divisor becomes positive, semi-positive, or negative in some sense. And the existence is proved in up to dimension 4, and also if the variety is general type, that is Birka, Cassini, Heiko, Makanan. And the relative version is concerned in this talk. So relative version is that everything is over a base space, S. Yeah. For example, so everything is S, over S. So not only variety X, but X and S, base. And all birational maps, birational transformations are done over the base, S. So for example, if S is an arbitrary singular variety, and X is an arbitrary resolution of singularities, and then the end product is called minimal resolution. Minimum model in this relative setting is called minimal resolution. And that now I enter the singularity theory. So now there is observation of there are similarity between minimum model program and semi-orthogonal decomposition. So the first example is that if you blow up a smooth variety along a smooth sub-variety, and then this is a typical example of divisorial contraction, then the exceptional divisor is a PN bundle if the codimension is N plus 1. So E prime is replaced by E, PN bundle over E prime. And the canonical divisor increases by N times E. And correspondingly, the derived category has this kind of semi-orthogonal decomposition. This is generalization of Bailinson's theorem. So the total category is similar to Bailinson's sequence of exceptional objects, but the last term is different. So this is a contracted variety. So in the Bailinson sequence, this was just O, but now I have this, and then minus 1 up to minus n. And this is due to Bondarov. Another example is a cone over Segre product. So PN cross PN prime embedded in large dimensional projective space. And then this is a cone. So if you blow up the vertex, then you get a smooth variety X tilde. And the exceptional divisor is just the product. Then there are two ways of contracting these exceptional divisors. So exceptional divisor E is a product. And then, so if you collapse all the PN primes, then what you get is PN. And if you contract all the PN PNs, then you get PN prime. So this is a typical example of flip. And the difference of canonical divisor is described in this way. So I assume that n is bigger than n prime, so that the direction is correct. And then corresponding semi-orthogonal decomposition is like this. So now it is shorter. So only from minus n plus n prime to minus 1 and then similar. So the flip and divisor contractions are very similar. And so there are two places to observe. So for example, canonical divisor, this formula is very similar, and also semi-orthogonal decomposition is very similar. In the particular case or general case, if this n and n prime are same, then it is called flop, and the derived categories are equivalent. So this is another example of different T structures. Derived categories are equivalent, but coherent X and coherent X prime are different, and they correspond to different T structures. Now, so the conjecture is that D and K should be parallel. D stands for derived category, and K stands for canonical divisor. So DK conjecture is that if there's a Bayesian map, X to X prime, and if there is inequality of canonical divisors, then there is semi-orthogonal decomposition of the category. So this is very hard conjecture. And it is a very challenging conjecture. And so, for example, if the canonical divisors are equal, then, for example, Hodge structures are isomorphic. So this is Kontsevich theory using motivic integration theory. So the conclusion is on the Hodge structure, but you need to build up big motivic integration thing, and then come down to Hodge consequence. And so maybe you need a bigger construction, and then come down to derived category. Derived category looks very big already at the beginning, but if you are accustomed to use it, if you are familiarized, then it becomes smaller and smaller, and many people want to construct much bigger thing. Yeah, so this is a particular case. Now, I want to consider singular varieties now. Yeah. So singular varieties, the derived category itself is not good. But case of quotient singularities I explained many times at other places. Simple singularities. Simple singularities very simple. So they are hypersurface singularities defined by these equations. So they correspond to Dynkin diagrams of type A and D and E. And Arnold called it simple. So Dynkin diagram of appears in many different fields in mathematics. And always something good happens and many good properties. So I can expect that in the derived category of these singularities also very good. And it seems so. For example, in the case of dimension two, n is dimension. So in this case, all these singularities, the surface singularities, are quotient singularities if the base field is K. K is C. And it is canonical singularities in the sense that any resolution, the canonical divisor is bigger. So this is called canonical singularities. And minimum resolution is always crepant. So if you take minimum resolution of simple singularities in dimension 2, then canonical divisor doesn't increase. So, and remember the DK conjecture. So if K is same, then K should be same. If K is same, then D is same. The opposite direction should be also something, but in this DK conjecture, K implies D. So what happens? So exceptional locus of this resolution is thinking diagram itself. Yeah, and what I have is McKay correspondence. So since K is equal, so derived category should be equivalent. But in this case, you need to modify the derived category, not the coherent sheaf of X itself, because this derived category is not good, as I said, because X is singular. But you should replace X by stack. So I skipped that part. But if the variety has only quotient singularities, and then you can always construct smooth stack. So you can think as if it is smooth, even if it's singular. So this stack is curly X, and then that is also very nice. And McKay correspondence is a big theorem, and that is expressed as a categorical equivalence. Of course, these have different heart. At the derived category level, they are equal. So in higher dimensional case, things are different. So they are so-called terminal singularities. Terminal singularity has no more blow up. Because if you blow up, the definition says that if you blow up, then the difference of canonical divisor is always strictly positive. So if there is any exceptional divisor, then it comes with positive coefficient. So the singularity cannot be cured, and so it's terminal. So there is no way, in geometric way, to cure these terminal singularities. But so what I propose is that there is some categorical way to cure these singularities. Yeah. So first of all, these singularities are not quotient in higher dimension. The fundamental group is trivial. And no crepant resolution in most cases. But some cases, there are crepant resolution. They are small resolutions. So if there are no exceptional divisor, just a curve. So in dimension 3, these are very special case. In dimension 3, and the type is A to M plus 1 and D to M. In these cases, these singularities have small resolution. That means exceptional locus consists of curves. But these are very special case. And other cases, always exceptional divisor appears, and so there is no crepant resolution. By the way, crepant is a word invented by Miles Reed from discrepancy. So discrepancy is the difference of canonical divisors. And if the discrepancy is zero, then it is called crepant. So if you look for dictionary, then crepant is not listed. So now the point comes, so I'm sorry, I don't have much time. So we look for categorical crepant resolution by taking categorical minimal resolution. So this is the idea. So for example, if the variety has type A1, so ordinary double point, or a cone of a quadric, smooth quadric, then the Kapranov says that the exceptional divisor E is just a smooth quadric. So if you just blow up once, then the variety becomes smooth, and the exceptional locus is quadric, smooth quadric. Yeah. So this has this exceptional sequence, full exceptional collection. So the shape depends on the parity of the dimension. So even dimensional quadric have this kind of exceptional collection. This one is so-called spinner bundle. And then all dimensional quadric have two related spinner bundles. And correspondingly, so canonical divisor have this expression. So canonical divisor increases. So if I take Y, it's too large, so I should decompose. So I should decompose derived category Y by using this exceptional collection. And the rest is denoted by DX. So this is a correct category of X. So this is crepant resolution of X. Yeah. So why it is crepant resolution? First, maybe I skip this part. So there are a special generator C in this crepant resolution. So both of them are contained in D of X. I have these two elements, and this element goes to zero by pushing down. So it is a relative element, and it generates all the relative elements. So this element C is very important, and Serre functor acts as a shift on this relative situation. So it should be relatively crepant. So crepant means a canonical divisor is trivial, relatively. And that means that Serre functor should be trivial. Serre functor becomes shift functor. So if the total dimension is even, then the Serre functor is shift by 2. And if the dimension is odd, then Serre functor becomes shift by 3. So it is relatively 3 Calabial category or relatively 2 Calabial category. So this variety X is has arbitrary high dimension, but the relative object has only 2 or 3 dimensions. So that is crepant. And also type 2 and in this case also I have similar thing. But in type E6, for example, So in this case, things are more subtle. So I have, again, a semi-automatic decomposition in this way. So the total category is decomposed into, these are exceptional collection, and then the rest is the crepant resolution. But the crepantness is different. So there are 3 sheaves, relative things. So the relative part is generated by two objects, and Serre functor is like this. So here, 2, so C1 is sent to C2, shifted by 2, C2 is shifted by C3, shifted by 2, and C3 is sent to C1, shifted by 3, not 2. So cube of the Serre functor is equal to shift by 7. So it is relatively 7 over 3 Calabial category. So dimension is 7 over 3. So it is not good, not simple, but still it has good property. And the final question is that, so this is very, very brave question. So let X be a variety with canonical singularities, then does there exist a categorical minimal resolution whose relative part has a fractional crepant filtration. So it is free filtered. So of course, I have an example of this kind of filtration, but I don't have time to explain this. But some crepant condition holds. Thank you very much.